Moses tells the Israelites that they are called to be a priestly kingdom and a holy people. Jesus sends out the disciples as laborers into the harvest. In baptism, we too are anointed for ministry, sharing God's compassion with our needy world. From our time of worship, we go forth to proclaim the good news, to heal the sick, and to share our bread with the hungry.
Good morning. You remember how to do this? It is good to see you. It is good to see anybody in these pews right now. You've been seen in my imagination as I've been preaching and leading worship in these past almost 3 months, but it is good to see you. And saying that, I must say it's good to see that many have chosen not to be here too. For their sake and for the sake of others that made the decision to not yet physically be here, and that is a good thing too. So I welcome all those who are continuing to worship with us via the radio or via the live stream on Facebook and so on. So welcome. With this being our first weekend of worship physically together since the middle of March, and with the concerns regarding the coronavirus certainly still with us, I will need to take some time during this service in a few places to explain that this is how we're doing things different right now, and maybe this is why, and so on. But there's a few things that I just need to share up front here. I am not going to be reading that entire two-page letter that we sent out to you about how we're doing things, but if you have not read that, please do, because that will help us all and help us all be more comfortable if and when folks decide to gather with us together in worship. That letter is available. It was sent out in the courier in the newsletter, but it's also on our website. If you go to Facebook, it'll lead you to the website and so on. But here's just a few things. While we're here, and please do what you can to maintain that at least 6 foot distance between yourself and non-family members, okay, for everybody's sake. And to provide a gathering that feels most welcoming to you, we are offering two choices of services regarding how we're approaching the wearing of face coverings or the face masks at the Saturday evening service. Last night, everybody was wearing face masks, and that's great because we are requiring on Saturday night that all folks be wearing face masks, except for the worship leaders when we're up here. We're far enough away from you that you're safe from us. And that's why we wear face masks, for the sake of others, to protect others. And I also learned right away, a face mask doesn't work very well with this microphone. It doesn't work well at all. But on Sunday morning, while wearing a face mask is encouraged, at least maybe when you're interacting or coming in or whatever, while they're encouraged, they're not required. So we're giving folks a choice on that if they feel better in a place where everyone's masked and they've got Saturday night, and then Sunday morning, while encouraging, it's your choice. While I have usually encouraged folks to sing out as we worship together, I would now ask you to tone it down. And I'm not going to pick out any particular people to say, hey, stop singing, so-and-so. No, I'm not going to do that. But unless you're at least like 12 feet from somebody, you can let it rip if you're up here or, you know, 12 feet away, but just kind of tone it down as far as the singing for the sake of others too. We won't be receiving the sacrament of Holy Communion just yet, and that's a hard thing because for many of us, one of the reasons we wanted to get back into this in-person physical worship was so that we could receive the sacrament. But we're taking this baby steps at a time, so we'll get there, and then there'll be some particular things that we'll be sharing with you about how we're doing communion. It will be different. It has to be different as from what it was in the past. But so for these non-communion services, you're going to be asked to be seated after the dismissal, which is kind of a strange thing. I'm going to say, go in peace, serve the Lord, or whatever it is at the end, but it's going to be go in peace. No, sit down for just a little bit. Because you're going to be ushered out. The ushers are going to come down the center from the back, And so that we don't have folks going past each other quite as much as they need to. We're going to limit that as much as we can. So they'll be doing that from the front, but they're also going to say to you folks on the ends, go out the side aisle. Okay, so just wait until the ushers dismiss you. Did I cover that, Travis? Okay, good. And while I would love to be at the back of the sanctuary greeting you when you leave, I've got a chance to touch base with a few of you before worship. While I'd love to be back there mixing with you, that's not going to happen just for a little bit, okay? We're not going to do that quite yet. I'm not going to be at the door shaking your hand. Someday, but not yet. Christians live with that, right? We live with the now, but not yet. So we can handle that. We can handle that. And as I said, there'll be other changes noted as we worship this day. I wanted to make sure that the announcements weren't half the service, so I'm going to stop with those kind of things right there. But for those at home who are worshiping via the radio or through Facebook or whatever, for those at home, if you want to follow along with the order of today's service, you can find that on our website. Zion's website is zionlutheranclinton.org, and there's a link there. You can just click bulletins and newsletters. And the bulletin is for this Sunday, June 14th. All right, let's do it. We'll see if you remember how to do this. Would you please stand and let's worship together on this beautiful morning. I must say, as I said last night, to hear the bell ring again is a wonderful thing. We chose not to ring the bell, even though we were worshiping here on Sunday mornings and airing it out there. But ringing the bell is kind of a call to come to worship, and we didn't necessarily want people coming to worship. But we hear it today as our call to worship. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation. Amen. Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sin. Reconciling God, we confess that we do not trust your abundance, and we deny your presence in our lives. We place our hope in ourselves and rely on our own efforts. We fail to believe that you provide enough for all. We abuse your good creation for our own benefit. We fear difference and do not welcome others as you have welcomed us. We sin in thought, word, deed. By your grace, forgive us. Through your love, renew us. And in your Spirit, lead us, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Amen. Beloved of God, by the radical abundance of divine mercy, we have peace with God through Christ Jesus, through whom we have obtained grace upon grace. Our sins are forgiven. Let us live now in hope, for hope does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you. Of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Overflowing with joy, we may freely share the blessings of your realm and faithfully proclaim the good news of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated. Let us hear the word.
At Sinai, God assured Israel, "You shall be my treasured possession," and commissioned them to serve as mediating priests for the nations. The people commit themselves completely to God's will. The first reading is from Exodus chapter 19. The Israelites had journeyed from Rephidim, entered the wilderness of Sinai, and camped in the wilderness. Israel camped there in front of the mountain. Then Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the Israelites, you have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings, and brought you to myself. Now therefore, if you obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession out of all the peoples. Indeed, the whole earth is mine, but you shall be for me a priestly kingdom and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the Israelites." So Moses came summoned the elders of the people and said before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. The people all answered as one, "Everything that the Lord has spoken, we will do." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please read Psalm 100 responsively. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all you lands.
Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into God's presence with a song.
Know that the Lord is God, our Maker to whom we belong. We are God's people and the sheep of God's pasture. Enter the gates of the Lord with thanksgiving and the courts with praise. Give thanks and bless God's holy name. Good indeed is the Lord, whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from age to age. We are no longer God's enemies, but have peace with God because we were brought into a right relationship with God through Christ's death. The second reading is from Romans chapter 5. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand. And we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
According to Matthew, reading from the 9th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas, and Matthew the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, Simon the Canaan, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: "Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. One of the things you may have noticed is that the bulletin, you know, this was kind of a quick turnaround in some ways. We haven't put all the sit and stand kind of stuff, so you've got that down and we'll tell you what to do. We'll get that back in. This is the point where we've got the children's sermon, and it doesn't surprise me to look out there and not see any children just yet. That doesn't surprise me at all, but I know that there's children listening. And I also know that from feedback I've received over these last many weeks of doing this, that older children seem to get into the children's sermon a lot too. And in fact, maybe more so than the other one. But, so I don't dare skip a children's sermon, even if there's no children around right here. So, in the last 2 or 3 months, I have seen a lot of these shapes in windows around town or around the area. I've seen them in houses, windows, and businesses, and churches. We've got them up here too. So, anybody seen any of these kind of things around? Anybody else have them in your windows or anything like that? If you do, for the sake of folks who can't hear us, what have I got in my hands? Hearts. Okay, I've got some paper cut out hearts here. Thank you, Judy, for making these. When you see something like this, when you see a heart, what do you think? What's the word? Love. Love. Okay, good answer. You do as well, almost as well as the children would. Okay. Love. And we use that word love in all sorts of ways. I do tell my wife I love her. I can also say I love ice cream. And so we use love in all sorts of ways, a whole range of categories. But some people went around and they asked a number of 4, 5, 6, and 7-year-olds to explain what love is. The question was, what does love mean? And I thought it'd be kind of fun just to share some of their answers, and we'll see how you react with these. This 5-year-old girl said, love is when a girl puts on perfume and a boy puts on shaving cologne and they go out and smell each other. Or this one. Love is when you go out to eat and give somebody most of your French fries without making them give you any of theirs. This was a 7-year-old girl here. Love is when you tell a boy you like his shirt, then he wears it every day. Two more. Love is when mommy gives daddy the best piece of chicken. And love, this is a 4-year-old. Love is when your puppy licks your face even if after you've left him alone all day. Now, if we were to ask our children, you know, tell us what love means, I'm sure we would have gotten some great answers there too. And maybe some of you at home will be hearing some of those answers of what does love mean. But I think if we really, really want to know, those are good answers. But if we really want to know what love is, the best place to find the answer is in the Bible. Because in the Bible we read that God not only told us what love is, God showed us, and God shows us what love is. In one of the Bible readings today, we heard this as its last sentence. I'm going to read it in a little different translation than we heard. But we heard God showed how much God loved us by sending Jesus to die for us, even though we were sinners. Wow, that's real love. God loves us so much that God sent Jesus, God's Son, to die for us, even though we don't deserve it. That's love. So, when you see a heart like this, there's a whole lot of things we can be thinking about, and our world right now needs love, and so I hope these hearts remind us of love, but I hope also it reminds us of the source of true and abiding and eternal love. And that is ours in God through Jesus Christ. All right? All right. Since we made some children's bulletins, in case there would be children here this morning, they're also out on the table where you picked up the tables where you picked up your bulletin. If any of you want one for yourself or to take to somebody else, feel free as you leave. Okay? Don't leave yet. I shouldn't say that. Somebody was waiting to go to the bathroom and now they feel they can't go. No, okay. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. I imagine that some of you know this, but I also know that some of you don't. The usual process for an individual to become a pastor in most of the different branches of the Lutheran Church in this country is that, first of all, you got to get your undergraduate degree. And I have to tell you that one of the joys of moving back to Iowa after 35 years of serving in Illinois is that I can now say the letters UNI and people know what I'm talking about. Okay? University of Northern Iowa. Well, after getting one's college degree, there are usually then 4 years of seminary education. Three of those years, and some of this is changing somewhat with online education opportunities and so on, but three of those years are spent in classroom education learning opportunities. One summer is also spent in a chaplaincy training situation, generally in a hospital setting or in a prison setting. And 1 year of those 4 years is spent in the practical learning opportunities within an internship congregation. So, my first year at seminary, I was single, but then 1 year after Nancy and I got married, the year after my first year of classes at Wartburg Theological Seminary, so after my second year of seminary, Nancy and I moved from Dubuque to Kansas City for my 3 months of clinical pastoral education. And after my chaplaincy training there at Trinity Lutheran Hospital, we then packed up everything we owned into our Chevette. Remember Chevettes? And we headed to California for my year of internship. We spent that year in the East Bay area of California, just a few miles from Oakland and Berkeley. And that year was filled with memorable and important experiences. And many of those experiences, of course, centered within the worship and education and service and fellowship life of Lutheran Church of the Resurrection in Dublin. But being in that area, we also took every opportunity we could to see the sights. And being two people who really enjoy hiking and bird watching, we took advantage of the parks and the wilderness areas of that region. And one of our favorite places was the Sunol Wilderness Area, the Sunol Regional Wilderness Area. It was only a few miles south of where we lived. And we went back to Dublin as a part of a West Coast vacation in the early 1990s, and we couldn't believe how much the area had changed with population growth in just 12 years or so. It was just amazing. I can't imagine it now. But it was wonderful to hike the unchanged miles of the Sunol Wilderness. It's a place where one can see yellow-billed magpies. Now, I'll try to hold down the excitement, okay? Okay. But that is a variety of magpie that can only be found in one part of Central California, in no place else in the world. It's a place where, as we were hiking in the foothills one day, we were surprised and were surprised by, and we surprised it, a bobcat sitting right in front of us on the trail. Sunol was a great getaway place for the two of us throughout that internship year. Okay, but on to the point of this personal nostalgia tour. A few miles back in the Sunol Wilderness, when we would hike up to one of the highest points in the area, we had some wonderful times with the eagles. There we were, right with them, with these huge golden eagles. You know, we are wonderfully used to around here now seeing bald eagles, and that's a real treat. But we don't often get to see golden eagles in this part of the country. And golden eagles, they're a lot more rare than bald eagles are. And these golden eagles would soar over us and around us and sometimes even below us as we're looking down on them. and in fact startling us by taking off from the paths right ahead of us as we were hiking. Huge, beautiful, majestic, golden eagle. And I will forever be struck with those memories when I read things in the scriptures like what we heard God say today in our reading from Exodus. You have seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. The Good News Bible translates this as, I carried you as an eagle carries her young on her wings. Now, the picture this passage of scripture paints is that of a parent eagle teaching a fledgling eaglet to fly. While that isn't really the case in the wild, there are a good number of places in literature that describe an adult eagle like pushing the little eaglet out of the nest, which might be right on the edge of a high cliff, and the young bird flaps its wings and it flutters trying to fly, but it keeps falling toward the ground, and as the adult bird is circling nearby, but just before the eaglet would be dashed to pieces on the rocks below, that adult glides under it and lets it land on the broad platform of its back and its wings. And eagles can have a wingspan of over 7 feet. So there's plenty of room to land on them. But as the stories go, after the parent catches the young bird, they go right back up to the top of the cliff to try it all over again, and they do this until the eagle learns to fly. And God says to God's people, I have carried you as an eagle carries her young on her back. Later on in the wilderness experience of the Hebrew people, God used another and a similar figure of speech in a powerful promise. The eternal God is your dwelling place, and underneath are the everlasting arms. And you might ask, underneath what? Well, this promise of God has a blank that you can fill in for yourself. Whatever burden of sorrow, whatever pain-filled suffering, whatever bitter disappointment or worry you may experience, underneath are the everlasting arms. I once read that one of the early explorers of the North Pole took many measurements of the depth of the Arctic Ocean at different places, and once he came to a place where all the line that he had wouldn't reach the bottom. So he recorded in his logbook the length of the line that he had, and then he wrote, deeper than that. When we can't touch bottom because of some terrible distress or catastrophe or some overwhelming circumstances of our lives, it is then that those everlasting arms of God reach way down, deeper than that, and hold us up. I have carried you on eagle's wings, was God's assuring words to God's people, and brought you to myself. How can you and I know this promise of eagle's wings and everlasting arms in our lives? Well, we have a reminder before us this day, the cross. I'm reminded of the story that has it, that someone once asked Jesus, do you love me? And Jesus, as the story goes, answered, yes, I love you. The questioner continued, how much do you love me? And Jesus stretched out his arms on the cross and said, I love you this much. Everlasting arms of love, and a very similar symbol of the outstretched wings of an eagle. In love, Christ carried the sins of the whole world on those outstretched arms. And then the wings of God lifted Jesus' lifeless body up out of the grave and restored him to life. The powerful, beautiful, majestic, and loving wings of God. Whatever burdens you have to carry in life, the most important question is not how much are you carrying, But who is carrying you? There are times when each of us come to realize that we can't make it on our own. But then some of the things that we turn to, thinking that they might help us, could be seen as sparrow's wings. They don't have very much lifting power. You know, they flap and they flutter, but they can't lift the heavy weight from us. They can't do what needs to be done. In the last book of the Bible, the book of the Revelation, there's one section that describes a woman whom God has supported. The woman is being pursued by a dragon. When all looks lost, she is given the two wings of a large eagle to fly away and escape. When you face your dragon, whatever it or they may be in your life, you don't want the wings of a sparrow. You want nothing less than eagle's wings. And that's exactly what God has promised you and me. I have carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. There is no load so heavy that God's wings can't lift it. There is no burden so great that it will break those everlasting arms underneath and around you. Now, for those of you who have a bulletin, and I hope you did see them and were directed by the ushers to them, if you have a bulletin, get that out right now. If you don't have one, and for those who are listening at home, you can turn in your Bible, but I want you to turn to the Old Testament reading from Exodus. Again, if you don't have a bulletin, and if you're at home, you can turn to your Bible to the Old Testament book of Exodus, chapter 19, verse 4. Take a close look at verse 4 of the 19th chapter. Got it? Now notice where the apostrophe is in the word eagles. Do you see it? It's after the S. Now, I know, again, another point of the sermon where you're getting real excited. I hope to explain what that's about. Those of you who will remember what your English teacher taught you, and Mrs. Schultz is always working in my brain, will remember that the apostrophe after the S means that it's not just the powerful wings of one eagle, but it's more than one. It's the mighty wings of a whole flock of eagles that are carrying God's people. The prophet Isaiah once said, "Those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles." Be sure to recognize what this verse is saying. We, you and I, can be a part of God's eagle's wings. We can be the part of the wings of God that sustain others in their times of trouble. We can be those who are watching out for those who are in need and in danger of falling in these troubled times. We can be a people who glide under those who need help, who need our protection, who need our voice out in this world as they fall or as they are pushed towards the rocky bottoms of life. Hear the promise of God. The promise that God will glide under you and lift you up, but also hear the call to be the feathers in the wings of God, helping to carry others through their grief and their loneliness and their disappointments and their feelings of hopelessness and their anger and their fear and their need. God works so many wonders through God's people. For the sake of your neighbor in this world, be a feather in the wings of God. We heard in today's gospel reading that Jesus gave his authority to cast out demons. He gave it to the disciples. Jesus' authority to cast out demons and to heal people. Now, in the thoughts of the eagle's wings verse from Exodus, Jesus was telling them to be a part of the ministry of God. Be a part of the caring, uplifting, encouraging, sustaining work of God in this world. God carried the Hebrew people a long way on eagle's wings in their pilgrimage from slavery in Egypt to life in the Promised Land. God is eager to carry you on eagle's wings in your earthly pilgrimage. You are invited to let yourself be lifted up out of the valleys and the shadows of your life and to be carried into the sunlight of forgiveness and love and promise. And as the Lord lifts you up, take the hand figuratively, in some ways literally, take the hand of someone near you or even far from you who is going through a dark valley and a tough time, and let God lift that person also, or that group of people, or that community, or that nation. Let God lift them up through you. May you and I be people through whom God works to lift others up here and now and forever. Amen. Let us together make a confession of our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into death. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Called into unity with one another and the whole creation, let us pray for our shared world. Holy One, you bring us together and call us your own. Bless theologians, teachers, and preachers who help us grow in faith. Guide your church that we might be a holy people. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Holy One, the whole earth is yours. Where there is fire, bring cool air and new growth. Where there is flooding, bring abatement. Where there is drought, bring rain. Inspire us to care for what you have provided. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Holy One, we have created divisions you will not own. In places of conflict, raise up leaders who work to develop lasting peace and reconciliation. Encourage organizations and individuals who care for all forced to leave their homes. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Holy One, you care for those who are harassed and helpless. Protect and defend those who are abused. Heal those who are sick. Feed all who hunger. Empower all whose voices go unheard, and help us respond to the pressing needs of our neighbors. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Holy One, you provide a plentiful harvest of gifts and resources. Prepare us to labor and gather the fruits of this congregation, that we might discover new ways of living. Minister to us in our work, that we do not lose heart. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great.
Lord God, we are a world and a nation that is diseased. We are not at ease, Lord. In regards to the COVID-19 pandemic, we continue to pray for those struggling with the virus itself, those grieving the loss of loved ones, those who are ill at ease, those who are isolated, those working in the medical and healthcare fields, and those involved in research and processes to develop a vaccine. Hear us, O God. We are also diseased with the open evidence of racism in our society. Help us to truly see the evils of racism and seeing, enable us to change as a nation, as a society, as individuals. Let there be change, Lord. But turn all hearts and minds and actions away from violence. Bring a change that is wrapped in your blessing of unity and peace. Hear us, O God. Holy One, you bring all people to yourself. We give thanks for the holy people who have gone before us. Sustain us in your mission until the day you bear us up to join the saints in light. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy.
Receive these prayers, O God, and those too deep for words, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Ah, thank you for sharing that with me, and thank you for sharing that with me through the radio airwaves in the last days. Yes, now don't you move to go near anybody, but wave and share a sign of peace with others, okay? And let that be a reminder that we are to be about that mission and ministry in the world, to share the peace of the Lord. God has blessed us in so many ways and with so many gifts. May God's gifts sustain you in these days, and may your sharing of God's gifts sustain others. Now, while we are used to receiving an offering, tell you what, why don't you have a seat here, okay? And in fact, we'll stay seated through the next song, and we'll stand after that. But while we're used to receiving an offering at this point of the worship service, you may have seen that the offering plates were at the entrance or at the exit of the sanctuary by each of the doors. And then when we do resume sharing the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, and as those who choose to be a part of that will be coming out here, there will also be a plate up here. Last night somebody asked me, does this mean that you're supposed to give when you come in and when you leave? I won't stop you, okay? But no, those are there for you to give your offering. Because offering is not just a way of paying the bills. It certainly helps with that. But that's not the intent of the offering within a worship service. An offering within the service is an act of worship of the Lord. It's reminding ourselves what God has given us is everything, and we give back to God. That is an act of worship. So we won't be passing the plates, because that's one of those safety measures. We need to make sure that we help protect people. So those are back there. Right now, let's sing together the peace of the Lord. Please stand if you'd like.
Let us pray. God of goodness and growth, all creation is yours, and your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. Water and word, wine and bread, these are signs of your abundant grace. Nourish us through these gifts, that we might proclaim your steadfast love in our communities and in the world. Through Jesus Christ, our strength and our song. Amen.
Throughout the scriptures, we are encouraged to pray. Let us now pray together as Jesus encouraged his disciples. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. God the Creator, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter bless you and keep you in eternal love. Amen. Christ is with you. Thanks be to God. Would you please be seated and wait to be dismissed? Sorry, Chris.